I wanted to say, first of all, my name's Tim Connors. It's really my pleasure to introduce to you these two fine people. I am particularly pleased when we're talking about child welfare that we have young ones in the room with us, you know? And remind us that this work that we do is sacred work. The decisions that we make affect the seven generations that follow. Just by way of background, I want to express my deepest gratitude to Justice McCormick from our Supreme Court, who has a background in child welfare and cares about this. This is made possible from money from our Supreme Court. I'm so pleased we have a new regional administrator, Jody Latuzic, who is here and has a background in advocating for parents' rights and for children's rights before she went into administration. So we are lucky that we have administrators and justices in our Supreme Court that understand the need and importance of this work. Kim and Jason, I met, I don't remember exactly when, what year, but I was a guest at the Washington State Tribal Forum, which is the work I do here, and I was presenting on some things we were doing in Michigan on the State Tribal Forum, and my wife and I, Margaret, sat down at a table for breakfast, and we were talking, and just found a spot. And I said, man, these judges in Washington are really hip. This is, God, I wish we had this like back in Michigan. I found out, well, no, they're the parent presenters, you know. And I said, and I heard about the program that Washington is doing. Professor Sankaran had heard about it. I met the people at the University of Washington. They were so successful in Washington that the legislature says, this makes sense. We're going to pass legislation to do this. And so while I was a guest in Washington to talk about progressive things our Supreme Court was doing in tribal-state relations, I said, you're really much more progressive than we are back home. And I said to Kim and Jason, I said, I need to get you out here. I need to get you out here. And they are coming back in December with Wayne County with and presenting. And at the last minute, we said, is there any way we could get them this week and get them here? I say this only because dreams can come true. And I'm going to turn it over because it's short notice. I have a docket full of motions of angry people. But I said, I need to go do something important right now and introduce these people, and I'll come back. I'll see you at lunch. But the real thing, the thing here is these fine people who have survived the path through the system, have come out the other end, and their experience can inspire and help others. And is that not our obligation to each other? So with that, I'll thank you. Welcome. I'll see you next. I'll turn over to our very fine Melinda Doolin, who we always rely on. So I'll see you later. Okay.
Thank you, Judge
Connors.
Yep.
Before you go,
yes.
Can
you
do a little quick icebreaker thing?
Sure, go ahead. Go right ahead.
So just want to share how grateful we are to be here. We had a really horrible time getting here yesterday. We were literally on an airplane from 6 a.m. Washington time, which is 3 hours. We got our hotel at 2, which they sold. So we just want to get that out the way. We're kind of tired, but, and then on the way there, I put some eye drops I thought was in my eye, but it wasn't eye drops. So I'm really conscious of my red eye today. So I had to get that out there so I won't be self-conscious.
Okay.
My eyes red. Then he has a nice little gift this morning, and he's feeling self-conscious.
Yeah, it's all right. On the way here, we hit a bump. I spilled coffee down the front of my shirt, so I just want to put that out there. So
welcome to Michigan.
It's Ann Arbor, it's alright.
I'm just going to take a couple minutes to sort of kick this off. My name is Belinda Doolin. I'm the Executive Director of the Dispute Resolution Center, and we are a partner with the Peacemaking Court. And in our partnership, we have developed a very good working relationship. So referee Susan Butterwick, who pulled all of this together in like 2 weeks, I don't know, she must have worked 24 hours a day for the last 2 weeks. She was called away for a family emergency up north, so she regrettably cannot be here today, so I'm just stepping in for her. Before we get going, I just want to kind of get a sense of who's in the room. How many parent partners do we have, or parents? do we have that has been a part of the court? If you could just raise your hand. We have Felicia Harvey, who's one of our parent partners, and Olga Turbo, who's one of our parent partners. I know we have guests from our state court administrative office, and I know we have attorneys who represent the parents, the children. If you can just raise your hand so we can know who you are. And I know we have members from either the Department of Health and Human Services or one of their contract agencies in the room. So if you can raise your hand, we can. So we have a pretty good cross. Oh, I'm sorry. And we have the peacemakers in the room, the actual people who volunteer their time to help families who are on the track for reunification get to that place of resolve so that they can reunite with their family. So you raise your hand. I said a whole lot about us because that's us, right? And they volunteer their time, so I just want to underscore that. And then, did I hit everybody? So I think what we have in the room is the cross-section of people who touch these families under the guise of the peacemaking court. So I'm so glad that you found value in today's gathering that you came to hear more about parent partner. So how did we get here? We've been doing peacemaking court. We piloted in 2013 with a subset of cases, domestic relations and probate. When Judge Connors was transferred to the juvenile court, we took peacemaking with him. We began to apply that process to cases on the docket for abuse and neglect, particularly when the family is on track for reunification. That pilot began last year. It is actually wrapping up. As a pilot, we're not stopping doing the work. It's wrapping up as a pilot, and the evaluation will be presented to the State Court Administrative Office within the next day or two. So we will have hopefully some wonderful results in that. I believe we will have some wonderful results in that. But in the process of peacemaking, just real quickly, it's the alternative dispute resolution process that brings together all of you who are involved with cases in a very safe and supportive process where we talk about the barriers that might be in the way of families, of parents, getting to that place where they can go back to court and go through the process and get reunified with their families. Sometimes these cases last a very long time. Sometimes it's a couple sessions and we're done. It just depends on what's pending, what's going on, and all of that. But as peacemakers who facilitate these meetings, we're not making any decisions. We're facilitating a dialogue. What we saw was that the parents needed a process of support or a mechanism of support that neither the court is equipped to give and agencies are not equipped to give. And we couldn't understand why they were disconnected, isolated. Some of those basic human needs were not being met for them when we have said, or the experts have said, they are on track for reunification. We believe that through positive connections, supportive connections, they can maintain the vigor and the energy and the motivation to do what's in that work plan and actually make some hard decisions about shifting their lives, their lifestyles, to get to that goal of safe children, be a strong family, and have a supportive community. So how can we fill that void? The court couldn't do it, the agencies could not do it, but is there something we can do as the supportive community? So Vivek shared this concept of parent partners. We talked about it a few times at the table, and as institutions often do, we keep talking about it. And we talk some more, and we talk some more, and then one day I was like, well, you know, I don't need to come to this meeting, we're not going to do anything. And then we decided, let's give it a try. Let's just start where we are. And so we had a couple focus groups 2 summers ago with parents who had been through the system or who were currently in the system. And the stories that we heard and the pain that we saw, even with parents who had been reunited for 10 or more years, were still carrying the scars of that experience and getting through the court system. And so it makes me quite emotional because I carried their stories and hearing them. So what they said to us is that we know we messed up. We know that we're still, something in us still allows us to want to be a good parent, but we don't have support. It's not easy being on this journey alone, And in order to make these critical decisions, I have to leave what I used to know, right? I have to leave that old environment. And so they're by themselves. We need help to think through a sounding board, a safe place to just scream, cry, and vent. Some days they don't know why they had to go to that hearing. Some days they're not satisfied with the outcome of the hearing. But that doesn't mean that we don't want to be the parent. It means that we don't understand or we're just struggling and frustrated. And as a parent myself, I have one child who's 15. What I do know from the day that I took my newborn baby home, you need support. I don't care what you got, how much resources you have. When I took that boy, when I was being discharged, I was in tears because I couldn't take a nurse home with me. And that's a true story. I was like, what am I going to do? What am I going to do with him? So parents need support. So we, with Vivek's support and help and insight, Parent Partners was born. And what that means, at the end of the day, parents who have been through the system are volunteering to extend themselves to parents who are currently in the system, to be that shoulder to cry on and what I simply call just to be a friend. They need friends too. So that's what today is about. And as we really want to beef this up and make it stronger and make it more available, we wanted to learn from those, from the experts, people who've been in the trenches for a while, who dealt with all of the ups and downs of getting this going. We've met through phone calls and emails, so I'm so happy to meet them, but I feel like I know them because we've spent a lot of time just to make today happen. So that's what it's about. Thank you for being here. Just a couple logistics. I put these on the table. Please write your questions down. I will be handing them off to Vivek and to Kim and Jason. They can give you answers. If we cannot answer the question because of time today, we want to keep these cards, get answers to your questions, and through email we'll relay that information. For this building, restrooms are just down the hall. Walk out the door to the right, just down the hall. We have water in the back, and I think lunch will be here somewhere around noon, okay? And you're welcome to stay and eat lunch with us. Okay, I'm gonna stop talking and hand it over, and you guys can do your more formal introductions, okay?
Sounds good. So it is a pleasure to have the job of facilitating a conversation between Kim and Jason. I met the two of them in Colorado about 3 weeks ago. And was at a training that we were both at, all three of us were at, and was totally blown away by their message. And I came back and I emailed, I think, Judge Connors and Referee Butterwick, and said, we have to bring them back to Ann Arbor. Little did I know that it would be 3 weeks later that somehow the world would, like, the stars and the moon aligned. And they didn't even know at the time they were coming in 3 weeks. What I want to do is just sort of guide them through a conversation about their experiences in the system, to their current role right now. The index cards are there. As things come along that pop in your head, questions you want to know, just write them down and pass them up, hand them to me, and we want to make sure that we get all those questions answered. So I want to start just with the two of you. If you want to just talk a little bit about how you first got involved with CPS, what you were thinking, sort of that first moment when Child Protective Services first got involved in your lives?
So, I initially got involved with the department. I was in a custody battle with my kid's mom, and there was a referral made. The social worker came out to the house. At the time, I had 4 months clean. I asked for some supportive services, some UAs, maybe some treatment services. And the message that I got was that I was too clean, and that they couldn't help me, and they had families with bigger issues. Fast forward that 9 months later, I had relapsed. I had started leaving my son at my mom's house, and I had two pending charges, and I was faced with a open CPS case, and I was under investigation, and they were removing my kid at an FTDM. Which is a family team decision-making meeting, and I remember feeling helpless and lost and confused. I didn't understand the papers that they were asking me to look at and sign. I remember feeling concerned about my son and where he was going and what that would look like. It was a real scary time. everyone had a lot of questions for me, but they didn't have very many answers for me. I have a lot of questions too, but no one seemed to be able to answer my questions. It was super scary.
Time out. Yes. Does everyone know this is a fishbowl and that, because I would think, I'm feeling like, do they know that ahead of time?
No.
So it's kind of awkward if we're talking to each other.
Yeah, so the idea is this is just sort of a conversation that the two of them are having, and so, which is why they're looking at each other.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
That's kind of weird. All right.
Thank you.
Time in.
Okay. So I am a mother who has given birth to 10 children. I've had 5 different CPS cases, dependency cases. In 4 of my cases, ended unsuccessfully, which means my rights were terminated for 9 of my beautiful kids, 4 in my first dependency case, 3 in my second, and then 1 in 1, which I basically, after those 2 came, I just stayed here because I thought once child welfare comes, you're going to lose me anyway. So at the beginning of those cases, I just stayed here as a baby when they came, and I didn't do anything. So during those, looking back in hindsight of those other 4 cases, the first 4 cases, I recognized that I had a lot of hopelessness, powerlessness, and the main factors for me in hindsight is that I feel that I lost my children to have my rights terminated because of lack of support at the right time, the right services at the right time, then I would go to jail when I'm ready to go to treatment. And then also what I was engaged with, I felt like people were not separating my worth from my behavior, and that it was all tied together, and they were telling me that I was the problem, and go fix yourself, and if I knew how to do that, I would have did that, and just the way it...
I wouldn't have done it a long time ago.
Yeah, the way I was engaged with wasn't helpful, and kept bringing up, and when I was making progress in some of my cases, I kept all over here, and every review was all this stuff I did wrong, and then this little bit I did good, and that blew me off a lot in hindsight. I left feeling defeated after 6 months of good progress. I didn't feel like it was recognized. So for me, it was a lot, in those 4 cases, it was a very hopeless experience. In my last dependency case with my 10th child, thank God I had 5, I was about 3 months pregnant. When I found out I was about 3 months pregnant, with my 10th child, I recognized I was the largest drug dealer in Washington, in my area, and I was a user of oil, and I was totally addicted, and I was too scared to die and too hurt to live. I developed PTSD. I'd been voluntarily committed to psych wards by then from the pain, emotional pain, that manifested in mental disorders when I had the grief and loss of my children and the guilt, shame, and remorse. And I remember on my 10th pregnancy, I just looked up to the sky, living a block, selling my wares, my dough, and I just said, God, I can't stop, but you can stop me. And that's when my life turned around with such great hope. And then I got arrested, and that's how I got delivered. And the sense of hopelessness and powerlessness in the process was very paralyzing for me in all my cases, except for the last one.
In the, I was brought to a place where hopelessness was just such a way that I lived. Right, from day to day, wanting to be a dad but strung out, and about a month into my case, the social worker started talking to me about adoption, and do I have family that would want to adopt my son, because there's no way that I'm ever going to change. And I remember that seed being planted in my head for a long time. It wasn't until I was about, so I got into a specialty court. I took that option because I talked to somebody who I knew somebody from the rooms of Narcotics Anonymous that was just getting ready to exit that program. And I called him, and he said, I'm going to give it to you real. If you want to get your son back and you want to get clean, choose this program. If you want to keep getting loaded for a little while, keep using drugs, choose voluntary services, and then you'll end up in that program. and that was a real message. You know what I mean? I wanted to live different, but I just didn't know how, right? And so that was probably the best message I could have gotten at that time, because I knew that he had been right where I was at, right? And I chose that program. But that seed that was planted when the social worker was talking to me about, I'm never going to change, and that my son needs to be adopted by someone who loves him. That was planted. I mean, I was 90 days clean before I was having a conversation with my social worker about maybe I should just relinquish. I mean, look it, he's got Pizza Tuesday. You know, he's going to the movies on Friday. I'm never going to be able to do anything like that for him. You know what I mean? It was that material thing, you know? It was really hard to try to be positive or look at anything that I was doing, carrying that around.
I can identify with that as far as a seed of hope, because in my last 10 kids, I turned my will and life over to care of God after I was arrested. I was in a 9-year prison sentence. And I remember while I was in there for 3 months, I just started reading kind of books about self healing, forgiving myself, and the Bible. I read a lot of that. And I found this scripture that said I didn't have to go to prison. So I ran around to everybody, look, I'm not going to prison. And I turned around and it said, if I turn my will and my life over to care of Him, He would have mercy and abundantly pardon me. So that word pardon said, won't, 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 won't. I was like, oh my gosh. If the government can pardon a murderer and the president can pardon Watergate people, I'm not going. And so no one believed me. They just told me to sit down, shut up. And so then my lawyer came two months in with a plea, 43 months instead of 108 months. He was all excited. I was pregnant with my 10th child. I was like, you know, about 6 months. And I was healthy. I'm feeling good. I was changing inside. Normally I would fight people. And when they called me names, I would say, oh, please forgive me. I'm so sorry. And they're like, what is wrong with you? What was wrong with me was God was changing me from the inside out. So He came with the plea, and I said, I'm so sorry, Travis. I can't take that plea because I'm getting out. And he's like, wow. I told him scripture, and he said, my gosh, you're gonna not only going to go to prison, but you're going for a long time. Please sign it. I said, I can't. So I went back to my cell, and he said, mental health to talk to me. And I had to change my mind. And but I wouldn't, but she turned out to be this birth to three worker for pregnant women and mental health professional, which I needed. And she started visiting me every week. And what I learned later was the guards would really block her and intimidate her and say, why are you visiting Kimmy May? But by then, it was my 49th arrest, my 23rd felony, right? So they're like, why are you wasting time with her? And she kept coming in. And that gave me some hope, too, because someone was coming and spending time with me. I'm not even on her caseload like that. And then the day of my trial, I remember my lawyer came back. He said, that you drew the plea. You're going to get 180 months at trial. You're going to lose because I bail jumped. I escaped. They caught me with a large quantity of drugs, then I bailed out, then I jumped the bill, then they caught me, and then I escaped from the custody. So what am I going to trial for, right? Mm-hmm. The day of my trial, I was 7.5 months pregnant, and they were shackled. I was shackled from my ankles to my wrist and my waist. Mm-hmm. And I went downstairs, and he came out, and he goes, are you okay? I'm so sorry. Are you all right? And I said, I'm okay, Travis. God's going to work it out. This is my trial. Everybody knows you need to hide in if you go to trial. So I thought God was going to deliver me before the trial. But 45 minutes later, he came out shaking. Saying, sign here, they're PRing you today, 0 to 12 month stipulated sentence. Now, 2 years later, when Channel 13 News interviewed them about that, because, you know, they couldn't explain why I got it. There's no such thing in Washington. So God got me out, and when I got out that day, the lady was waiting for me at the door, and she didn't listen to my lawyer. She already got me a trooping bed ready just in case. Even though I told her, trooping bed is going to lose. Don't you waste your time. She did. And she took me straight to Swedish Hospital in Seattle. And there's a maternity thing, you just lay down all day, eat, you know, monitors on you, do meal groups, clean and sober, you know, treatment stuff. And it was beautiful. And then a week later, my baby was dying inside of me. They had 5 minutes to give me emergency C-section. And he told me if I had been in jail a week ago, that not only she would have died, but I could have died too. So her name is Heaven Miracle. Mm. And for the first time in my life, when I knew I had a name, every time I had a baby, I had a red flag on my name, right? Because there's a flag that says, come see Kimberly Mays. And that's how my kids got pulled, whether I was clean or not. They were pulling on my past history. So here they came again. And I already lost 9 kids. I had this 10th baby. I turned my life around. You know, I mean, I went to jail, but I felt I changed. And I was ready to parent. And a lady asked me, it was an African-American unit. They don't have that anymore. They need to bring it back. And they said, Miss Mays, do you want to keep your baby? I said, excuse me? Never heard that. So she let me keep my child. And I went from there to an inpatient treatment, moved back to Tacoma, which is 20 miles from Seattle, and then I was enrolled in college, and I got mental health support services, pregnancy services. I enrolled in everything I needed to enroll in. I was going to church, and I was went to DOC, made them give me UAs 3 times a week, made them, and got an IOP, and I was doing great. So I enrolled in college, and my worker, the same beautiful lady who went to the door, back then in Washington, you couldn't get welfare if you had felonies, only a child. So I wanted to go to work and get a car so I could go start school in January. I was already ready to start college. Mm-hmm. She said, call CFWS. That's not CPS. They can help you with daycare. I said, oh, great idea. Call CPS. I mean, CFWS, left my name. An hour later, all, I guess all my old workers were supervisors there. So you hear them all in the background. One's on the phone. Oh my God, Kimberly, you got a baby? Right? Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh yeah, calm down. It's all good. 7 months documented clean in jail and out, right? Mm-hmm. I've been doing UAs a week, so they sent two workers over, CPS and CWS. And they came over, I showed them all my UAs, I gave them all the numbers to my probation officer, the mental health professional I was working with, the birth to three parent program, the home, the public health nurse, my pastor, who I go to church every 3 times a week. Everything's good. My college enrollment, boom. They said, great job, we'll pay for it. We'll pay for it. We'll find daycare, we'll pay for it. Great job. The next day,
that knock.
So I'm breastfeeding, right? Right? She's 3 months old. I'm doing it, right? And I heard that knock, and her dad didn't know the knock. And I remember it slowed me. I don't know why. He should know the knock, too. So I'm going, it's like slow motion. I was like, don't open the door. I can see that in slow motion still, and the door's open. Boom. Please, boom. The workers are in tears. Because all my old workers and supervisors are there. They say, I don't care what Kimberly Mays has done. Go get that baby. So that was my experience. And then I got there. So after that, they took my child. And then I didn't know how to get my head together. And then I just knew at the 72, when I had a court hearing, they said, I'm sure the judge is going to unravel all this. I brought all my stuff to 72. The DOC head guy came. The head of the agency I worked with, they all came. They were just flabbergasted, right? Right. And the judge, because of based on my history alone, no imminent harm, kept my kid in care. And I left that. That was my turning point, my crossroads. So I'm leaving the courthouse, and he's driving, I'm sitting there, and I'm like, God, I don't have no understanding. I don't trust you right now. I don't know why I can even keep serving you if you let this happen. And but then something came out of me and said, but you hold the words of life. I'm not going nowhere. But it was really hard. I got mental health services, but in hindsight, I learned that the reason they took that kid was a higher power thing, because then I took my daughter, I'd be electronic repair technician. But so during that case, my only main hope in that whole case was the judge, and my very first and next judge in my hearing retained my case, and he said, yeah. They would say, blah, 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 9 years, blah, 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 blah. And he said, yes, that's true, but look what she's doing now. And right. That's my hope came. I said, huh? And so me and him was like this, and that was kept me moving forward. And my ISSP said this. One sentence, continue engaging the services that you are engaging in.
Mm. You know, when
okay.
The place where hope in my case came in, I had about a month clean. I was already having conversations with my new social worker about the possibility of me not being my son's father anymore, right? And I was at a Narcotics Anonymous meeting, and I heard this lady, Sherry, who's a parent ally. I didn't know she was a parent ally, but she was sharing about how she had had multiple CPS cases, and that her last case, she had 5 years clean, and there was something with a teenager or whatever, and she lost her kids at 5 years clean for a couple months, stayed clean through that process and got them back, and I was like, ooh, I need to know how to do that. And so I went and talked to her and was like, I have a CPS case and I need help. Like, I need help on how to do what I'm doing. I have no idea. And that's when I first got connected with a parent ally. And the thought and the idea that I could do this process, right? Because at the time, I was just showing up. Because the program that I was in, they had the ability to give you a sanction that included jail, right? And so I knew I didn't want to go to jail. I've been to jail clean once. They already put me there once. That was bad. I'd never been to jail clean before. But I wasn't sure about what was going on, right? And in talking with this parent ally, I was doing a lot of this. I was doing a lot of talking, but I wasn't doing a lot of work, right? I wasn't working on myself. And I hadn't cried. I hadn't cried for my son. I hadn't cried that I willingly gave him up, right, by the choices that I was making. And being able to accept that piece, right? Being able to accept that I didn't lose him, right? It wasn't that I went somewhere and lost him and couldn't find him. It was that I willingly gave him up, right? Because of the choices I was making. And the thing was, is that I cried then, when in that conversation, that I cried. I did not have my son. And, like, this is what my life had become based on my choices, my history, my family issues. And that's where I came to the spot where I started making a choice that I wanted to do something different. And really starting to apply myself into the programs that I was involved in, DBT and family counseling and my treatment program and going to meetings and really developing that foundation, right? And I remember having that conversation with a parent ally, and, you know, I was talking about, you know, not being my son's dad anymore, and I was talking about all the things that, you know, that, you know, the family could give him that I couldn't, right? And, you know, the parent ally pointed out to me, it said, you can give your son one thing that no one else can, and I was like, what's that? And they said, a father's love. You're his dad, and you're the only one that can love him like a father, because that's who you are. And I remember just crying. I remember crying so hard for, I don't know, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. Because I felt that pain of not having my son and not being able to be there to show him, you know, the things that I needed to show him as a father, right? And that fueled my drive. It was the start, the spark that that got the engine going, right?
So both of you talk, one of the words that comes up over and over again is the word hope. And can you talk a little bit more from your experience, but also from your work with parents, what role you think hope plays early on in the process in a child welfare group?
Hope gives the, as I said, it's fuel. Hope reduces the fear and anxiety, and it reduces the guilt, shame, and self-loathing that parents can have without hope. Hope paints a picture of the road ahead. Mm-hmm. And gives you pavement to walk on and a light in which to guide you
through that darkness. I mean, it's dark. The, you know, the social workers have too many cases, can't get a visit, right? And parents that I work with now and talk with them, it's, let's help come up with a plan, right? And for one, I'm tangible evidence sitting right in front of them that I did it. You know what I mean? And I share pieces of my story about where I've been and things that I've done. And you know, you recognize that because you've been through that as well, right? You know, you're like 5 minutes talking to somebody, and you're like, oh, yeah, I know exactly where you've been. Like, we never hung out before. Yeah. So we started working together, right? But you, talking to you for 5 minutes, I'm like, oh, you can take me right there. And I can picture, you know, being out on the block. You know what I mean? And same thing with the parents. Like, they go to that place of, like, yeah, I get right where you're at. Like, I was sitting in this courtroom not knowing what to do, right? But it's doable, right? Well, like, I can help you do it.
Yeah.
And I know that there's everything in this world has a price tag on it, right? The court cost, the this cost, the treatment cost, all the costs. But this is one aspect of the system that's lacking. And the coolest thing about it, that it's free. Hope is free. It doesn't cost anyone anything. It doesn't cost me anything. It doesn't cost you anything to instill hope in a person and help give them that light.
You know, I think about hope when the parents call or we meet them, and they'd be all like this, and it's over, and I can't do this, and it's not fair. And then
right.
After 5 or 10 minutes, they're, oh, yes, I can. They got their cape on their back, their S on their chest, and their plan in their hand. And that's the one, the beauty of this work, the plan in their hand. Not only in their head, but in their hand, with some concrete stuff written down, or they tap down and put their head up. And so that's hope to me, saying, yes, it's doable, and give me a couple steps, A, B, and C, and how you can get there. And success breeds success, failure breeds failure. So just giving parents that 5 minutes of something they can do, one thing for successful, leads to another act of success.
Right. Small attainable goals. That's what I try to help when I'm working with a parent. I try to help them see that, right? And I tell them, I said, look, I get the big plan, reunification. Okay, that's a huge idea, right? It's doable, but it's a big idea. Let's work on this week, right? Let's work on getting to your visits, right? And having a plan around that and what a visit looks like. You know what I mean?
Like eating an elephant, how to eat an elephant. Right. One bite at a time.
Right. You know what I mean? And that's the thing, is like giving that parent the hope, right, that they can do it and help them come up with a plan around the plan.
Yes.
They get a list of services, right? Go get a psychological evaluation. I had never even heard of a psychological evaluation until I was in this system. Yeah. You know what I mean? What is a psychological evaluation? What does that mean? Right? But being able to explain that, social worker's busy. Judge Connors, he had to run out of here because he's got a big courtroom full of angry parents. You know what I mean? Angry people. Angry emotions is what he said. You know what I mean? It's like, the loads are so much, right? Yeah. Parents only got one case.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And helping them see that, right? Helping them see that, letting them know they have the power.
Yeah. 95%, right? I think.
Pick it up.
Carry the case.
Yeah. You know what I mean? They can drive it.
Yeah.
So what are the barriers you see? So you talk about hope, you talk about how important it is. From either your case, but also just generally the work that you all do with parents, what do you see the barriers are for them?
The number one, I've been doing this work for 10 years, hands-on with families, and the number one barrier I see is how they're engaged with. Human beings can feel if you're talking to me as a person with value, and my behaviors over here, I've got to go, they're jacked up, but you are valuable, versus you and your behaviors are jacked up, and we want to rescue the kid from you. That feeling is a horrible feeling, and that's what it makes a parent defensive, and they're already battling low self-esteem, self-loathing, guilt, shame, remorse, and then you come in a room with a bunch of professionals, and you feel like you're already fighting your own guilt and shame, and without any engagement that lifts you up, that lets the parent know immediately at that first meeting, hey, I understand this is some hard times, I know you love your kids, I know this is... You meant well, we're here to help. We don't know what's going on. We have all these allegations coming in. We don't know if all was true, some were true, or whatever, but we really want to work with you. We need you, your help, in order to help
your family.
We need your help, parent, in order to help your family, and not, we're going to come fix you guys.
So, right. We got all the answers we just met you 5 minutes ago.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, one of the biggest barriers that I faced in my case was backgrounds, right? Here I was, a drug addict, strung out. You go to court, in any court system, really. You go to DUI court or criminal court, right? You're on DOC, in dependency system, right? What happens? You have a drug charge, DUI, something like that. They say you need treatment. You go to treatment. Treatment introduces you to the 12-step program. 12-step program. Get out. We need you to go to sober supports. We need you to go to AA, NA meetings, right? They send you there. That's where you draw your support. My family didn't want nothing to do with me. None of them wanted to talk to me. So I learned that I made my own family there, right? So my brothers and my sisters that had significant clean time, right? They couldn't help me in my case because they couldn't pass a background. So that's the very place that I got sent for support. They couldn't be supervisors to supervise my visits. They couldn't be transport to help me transport my kid because I didn't have a license. What's a license? I had keys. That's all I ever needed, right? And that was a barrier, right? I met my wife in our classroom, right? And her and I, we were getting ready to... We move in together. And she had prior background. She had felonies. Can't return your kid. The supervisor looked at me and said, I had almost 9 months clean, was engaged in all of my services. She, at the time, had 8.5 years clean. Kids in her kids in her home, all, you know. And the supervisor looked at me and said, as long as you're with that woman, we will never return your kid. Mm. And, you know, I didn't handle myself appropriately. You know, that made me angry. But the thing was, is that, you know, having someone there say, hey, it's going to be all right. You know what I mean? And that support that I had that I've sought, because I've been trying to get clean for a long time, right? That support that I had sought out in Narcotics Anonymous, they helped me with that. You know what I mean? They helped me see, like, well, just wait them out. That's what my sponsor said. He said, just wait them out. They don't want to keep your kid. You're clean. Just wait them out. They ain't going to keep them forever. And that was part of what I did, right? I helped use my attorney and stuff. And, you know, now I work with dads. I work and do a lot of work with dads. I work with moms, too. But, I mean, I get just saying dads all the time. And, you know, one of the biggest barriers that I see for dads is that, you know, a lot of times they're non-resident dads, right? They weren't living in the home with the child the time the child was removed, right? And for whatever reason, they don't have visitation, whether it's on the mom or it's on the dad. I know trying to navigate the family court system, that's a nightmare. I mean, you got to be a lawyer to be able to do that. To get visitation, unless you can come to an agreement, right? And lawyers are expensive. Dads get met. So mom, something happens with mom, child's removed, right? Mom gets into treatment. I don't know who dad is. I don't know where dad is, but I know all these things about dad, right? Dad comes on to the case 8 months later. Social worker comes up and says, we have all these things that we've already heard about you. Hi, my name is Miss Social Worker, and I have a psychological evaluation, an anger management class, and domestic violence, and I'm going to need you to take some UAs. And dad says, I don't even use drugs. Right? But that's how they're met. And that's a huge, I mean, right off the bat, you just pronounced my name wrong, ma'am. And you want me to do all these things. Right? That's a big barrier.
Another barrier I've seen over the last 10 years, a significant barrier, is resources. The ability to even get to the appointments, with transportation, bus fare, which they don't have, parents don't have, housing, or not being, the referrals not coming in. So a parent comes to our system up in Washington, and so much turnover that a referral that we pull the kid at 72, we say we order some visits. We don't hear back from nobody for a month.
Where are the visits?
Hey, don't even hear back because the case is changing. So that's a barrier. The turnovers for the professionals is a barrier because parents can't even find me, and I can't even, I'll call, and even the department can't find out. They don't even know, in some cases, who's assigned social worker. So that's a barrier. And then the barrier of resources, just the poverty piece that precludes parents from who want to change from even getting there. Then there's the lack of the programs, there's a waiting list for treatment. So I'm an addict, and I can't go into treatment, and 6 months later, I can have a termination trial by then. So that, to me, is a leading barrier to me in child welfare, is not only the engagement piece, but the system needs to put more money, because we say it's all about the children, right? The children want to go home desperately, safely. We want them to go safely. So we as a system are not putting the funding under the parents in order for us to fulfill the children's desires. So we're not doing the best interest in the well-being of the children because we're not putting enough money into those parents who they want desperately back. Like air. Like my air depends on this, my heartbeat depends on this.
Children need their parents.
Healed and, you know, safe.
Safe.
But without the right resources, focus, and the right engagement, or being creative and innovative with every single parent so they can get to these things they need to and get that support. Because even parents that have us, if they can't get to the service, then we can't help.
Well, the thing is that one of the huge positive factors in helping break down those barriers, right, is working with a parent ally. They're at court. They've already been through it, right? They know that they're going to be a waiting list. So instead of that misconception of, I'm ready to go to treatment.
Yeah.
Where's my bed?
Yeah.
Right? Parent ally can look at them and say, I too wanted to go to treatment. But it took 3 months.
Yeah.
This is what I did in the meantime, right? I went to IOP. I had this group. I went to meetings, right? I asked for extra UAs to help keep me accountable, right? Whatever it was, we can relay that message to try to help navigate because it's confusing.
So what did you all do then? I mean, you talked a little bit about this, about the barriers you face. In your cases, what did you do? How did you overcome the barriers? Like, what steps? Did you have a parent ally? Were there folks who helped guide you along the way? Like, what gave you that sort of strength to overcome the game?
In my other four cases, nothing. But in my last case, it was basically the community support that I had gathered for myself. I had a huge community support network and a great church, and that's what helped me get through the barriers of lack of resources. I was in college, full-time college, so I started being socialized and learning more, and that helped me understand, separate the barriers from my ability, and it gave me passion and desire to move forward. So I just focused on my college education, dived head first, got straight A's all the way through, and then I focused on my business, my child, my services. So I just focused and on my last case, and I did it so well that I got, I ended up earning from that, from my baby being 6 months old, from January and 5.5 years later, I earned an AABA master's degree, straight through 5.5 years, straight A's, 5.5. So I just focused. So while I was in doing my case, for it was 11, my case was open 11 months as far as out of home, 11 months. And all I had on my ISSP was to continue doing the services that you've already signed up for. So, but miraculously, after my baby was moved back in my care, at my dismissal, the judge had a party and shut the courtroom down, and just to honor me getting this child back, and asked me to start the first parent for parent program in Prince County. So that was a great outcome of that.
Good for you.
The what helped me through my barriers, I mean, part of it was, I was connected with a parent ally. Part of it, and it wasn't. I didn't get connected with a parent ally through the court model. Mm-hmm. When parent for parent, I got connected with just a parent ally that had been through the system, that had navigated it several times, that was willing to help me out, right? And but the other driving force, you know, helped. That person helping call me on, actually call me on my crap.
On your crap. Yeah.
Really, I mean, there's no other way to say it. You know, when I was wanting to, you know, when I was wanting to act out, because, you know, that social worker looked at me and said, oh, we will never return your son as long as you're with her. Right? I mean, that gave me fuel right there. Well, I'm going to show you.
Can I share with you?
I'm going to show you.
Can you, on my 10th child, my first meeting with the social worker, when I came in after the 72-hour shelter care, right, and I'm doing great, she said, hello, Miss Mays.
Yeah.
Within 5 minutes, she said, I see you've lost 9 children in 4 different CPS cases. By law, I can fast-track you, and I don't have to offer you any services. And I can tell you right now, Miss Mays, you would never parent another child in Washington State or any other state. And by then, God had changed me so much, I did act appropriately. I said, I made her take my hand. I said, ma'am, I can respect how you feel, but I can show you better, I can tell you that I'm getting my daughter back. Thank you, and have a nice day. And again, I held her hand the whole time. And I said, thank you so much for helping me and my family reunite, right? And then I said, oh, I let her go over her hand. And I said, oh, by the way, can we meet every Friday? I would really like to stay on point. And so I met with her every Friday, and she was just so rude to me. Every time I thought I had to breathe, go, how you doing, Carolyn? Nice to see you today. Thank you for meeting with me. Oh, I love those shoes. Right? And she said something negative last year, 5 years ago, 4 years ago, blah, blah, blah. And that happened for 6 months straight. But every single time I would reach at the end of that meeting, I would say, thank you so much for helping me and my family. I appreciate your help. 6.5 months later, we're at a meeting. She turned her head around the exorcist. Went off on her supervisor and said, give her baby back. So I won her, like you said. I won her. And you know what?
The thing was, is that we just got married this last July, but at the time we were just dating, it was her background, right? But I had visitation. I had like 20 hours of visitation every weekend, right? Unsupervised for 6 months, and I filed a motion, denied because of background. Filed a motion, denied because
of background.
Her background. Mm-hmm. And, I just kept praying and seeking, like, is this what I'm supposed to be doing? Is this what I'm supposed to be doing? And I invited the social worker and the guardian ad litem. I said, come over anytime you want. Just stop on by. I mean, we got visitation. This, come by when my son's not here, right? Because there's other kids in the house. Mm-hmm. See how we function, right? Come see, right? And it was, you know, every time we go to court, the AG would, you know, drum up her background. I mean, my background is bad too, but it's my son. Mm-hmm. But we go into court, and my attorney comes running over. Did you see the guardian ad litem report? And I was like, no, I haven't seen it yet. But did you send it to me? She's like, no, it's right here. It just came in. Look, and we go in the what the guardian ad litem report said. I have done many unannounced visits, and this is a family. The only piece missing is Jason's son. Overnights need to start immediately, so that this child can start to find his place in this family.
Yeah.
And my attorney said, you know, we'd like to return, you know, start overnights and return home. the guardian ad litem's attorney said, you know, yeah, you know, that was her report. Department stands up again, says, do you realize this? And started drumming up the history again. And what was hugely helpful and made me feel, you know what I mean, was the judge said, I'm sorry, do you have anything new to say? and the AG goes, but Your Honor, and the judge said, stop. Is there anything new? Do you have anything else to say besides what you've already said for the last few months? And the AG said, no. The judge said, well, then sit down. And that, I was like, whew, okay. I've never seen that before.
Yeah.
And that not only gave me hope, but it gave the other people in the program that I was in, because everybody had to come to court, right?
Yeah.
Everybody sits through, everybody going up and talking to the judge,
yeah.
Right? And so that not only gave me hope, I mean, I knew he was coming home, right? Because I had set my mind to it. I prayed. I talked to God. He told me, just keep doing what you're doing, right? Because the department came to me and said, we would like to offer you a Section 8 voucher. We would like to offer you some furniture. We will furnish the house, and we will help you with, you know, all these different things. And you can move into the house, and we'll return your child right now. And then 6 months from now, when we close the case, you can just move right back into your girlfriend's house, you and your son. And I, you know, that was a crossroads for me, really, because I didn't know what to do, right? I mean, we'll give your son back right now. You move into this apartment, we'll give you some furniture, da-da-da-da, right? And I really, you know, I talked about my support group, you know, the people that could help me with my case because of their backgrounds. I talked with God, my sponsor, and, you know, the thing was, is that I went back to the department and I said, so if I take this Section 8 voucher and this furniture and stuff, and then once I move back into her house like you're telling me I can do after the case is closed, does this voucher just go back and somebody, another family can take it? They said, no. I said, well, then I can't accept this. Because there's nothing wrong with my home besides what she looks like on paper. That's it. So I'm going to just sit here and keep doing what I'm doing. They said, oh, so you're saying you're going to choose this woman over your son. I said, no, I'm choosing humanity. I'm choosing family. This is our family. This is my family. You might not see it yet, but that's what it is. And I'm not going to change anything. That's a resource for a family that's homeless. Get a family off the street. Put them in there. I have a home. And there was a lot of hard things, hard decisions to make, you know what I mean, throughout my case.
So when I first heard your story a couple of weeks ago, I was sort of blown away just by the power and the strength of it. But in the back of my mind, I was thinking, here are two exceptional people who've overcome these huge odds, but are they really like, is this doable for most of the parents in our system? And I'm curious as to like whether your thoughts after working with so many parents, are these stories sort of possible in more cases and we're just not hearing about them, missing them? So what do you think?
When I first started this work, I would get disinvited, and then disinvited because they said Kimmy's deception, that other people can't possibly be this way, so it's not bringing her because it sets the bar too high. And that's not true. Since doing this work, there's hundreds of people just like us, college educated, working throughout the system in Washington State. And what I learned from my practice is that about 85% of parents can safely reunite with the right resources and support because they have the ability inside them, but it's always is not in place.
It's daunting.
But 15% on a continuum will never be able to parent. Some maybe later, and there's a certain percentage that never can because of mental, whatever, issues, whatever.
Right.
But that 85% mark is not being represented because on our caseload, we have a 85 to 95% return home rate just on our caseload. So everyone doing the same thing we're doing, that should be a state average.
Right. I think that especially when we're traveling around and they're like, well, we need you, Kimberly, or we need you, Jason. We need you to move here, right? What the thing that I think is hugely missed is that every state has a Kimberly. Every state has a Jason. They just haven't found them yet. There hasn't been the right supports, the right opportunities, or a program to allow those parents to grow and flourish in the system, right? I've seen it now with parents and dads that I've worked with, not only through Parent for Parent and the program that I work for now, but also through Father's Engagement. I'm out here in Michigan. I almost said Colorado. I'm out here in Michigan, right? And so there's things that I was doing when I first started this work, committees and different things like that. And now I got dads that are coming through that have gone through Father's Engagement that are now like, we want to do what you do, right? We want to give back like you do. We want to be that guy standing there meeting the dad that's just coming out of prison, that's just coming, walking onto the dependency floor. My dependency has been open 2.5 years. I just got out of prison. I'm here with a backpack. I want my kid back, right? And then being able to talk to that dad and say, you know what, you can totally do this, right? Your case isn't dismissed. It's not a termination. Let's go. Let's get them babies. Let's go talk to your social worker. Let's go talk to whoever. Let's go meet your attorney. You know what I mean? And that's another piece also with the parent allies being at the court, right? You got a parent walk in. The parent allies, they're at court every day. Well, I mean, in King County, I don't know about other systems, but... You know, and they know who the social workers are, and they know who the attorneys are, right? So they help parents when a parent walks in and says, I don't know who my attorney is, I don't know, you know, oh, well, here, you need to come over here and get screened first, right? Oh, here, this is your attorney. You're looking for Tiffany. Tiffany's right over here. Let me show you where she is, right?
We also help parents not act a fool in court, too. That's another big thing. because we understand that people, it's human nature to seek power in crazy places when you can't seek in the places that you desire.
Right.
And so we really help parents understand, like, the one thing you told them, like, one dad, when he was like, oh, fuck this, and you said, ooh, I totally understand how you feel. That's how I felt. You know, and you told him how you threw the chair at the FGM, right? And you say, but what I earned was...
Right,
well, I got a measurement assessment, and that's how you about, right? So parents, we help share with parents, you're right, but being right's overrated.
Right.
Focusing on life's not fair, neither is the system, so we'll give them that. Maybe it's not fair, but that's life on life's terms. And so that's the beauty of what we can give them is give them some act right. You know, we tell them that it's like fighting a bear with a toothpick. How do you fight a bear with a toothpick? You cannot, because it'll take your whole hand off and your head next. That's why you can use your power smartly. Then it's not like fighting up. So when you yell at your social worker, cuts people out, so get my kid back now, that's fighting better too, baby. And you always get your hand bit off first, and then your head second, and you're still standing.
And the thing is that one thing that what I've learned and helped parents with lately, especially, is, you know, you can't fight the system within the system, right? Like, let's get through this.
Yeah.
The goal, reunify with your children or your child, right? That's the goal, okay? Let's not lose sight of the goal. You want to combat the system, you want to help change the system, that's fine, but you can't change the system when you're in the system, right? You have to wait till you get out of the system to then turn around and come back like I am, right? Like, there's parts of the system where I was like, ooh, right? Ooh, that's bad. You know what I mean? And, or that's good, we need to do that better, right? Oh, Let's do more of that.
Yeah.
Right? Less of this, more of that. You know what I mean? And the thing is like, that was the other thing. I couldn't change what was going on. I'm right in the middle of it.
And another thing the parents get hung up on is the allegations. So a lot of them, I just feel them. Every parent across the United States of America, probably abroad, come in with so many lies, so many half-truths, and so many truths. Mm-hmm. The problem is, nobody other than you know what the real truth is.
Right.
So, with helping people know that they're not the only ones with the lies and the half-truths and the truth, it was very helpful, I found, for parents. And saying,
helpful.
And then you come, if we would only focus on the issues we know are going on, that we know are true, and work with our attorney to get that presented in a beautiful format, like, yes, parent says, I have this issue, I want to work on it, I am good parent, right? Then we can get the work done without, instead of worrying about all those lies. And I was telling them, the lies will fall off. So don't even worry about the lie, who cares? Focus on what's happening, care about what's happening in your family, and be that asset to your own.
Be the advocate.
Yeah, and an asset. Be an asset. You don't you be the deficit.
Right.
What else? So you have a room full of caseworkers, attorneys, community members. You've talked a lot about the work of parent partners, but what should the rest of us be doing? Right? If you were in our sort of role in our systems to inspire, to give hope to parents, to help them overcome barriers, what advice do you have for all of us?
A couple things. One, it's important that parents are talked to as if their value and their behavior, their value and worth and behavior are separate. That's huge. And letting parents know at the beginning, I know you love your kids. I know you want your kid back. We want you to have your kid back. But my hands are tied. Mm-hmm. Until these certain things happen, I cannot return them. So that's better. That's a huge one. And then understanding that when a parent misses a service or a court hearing or a visit, find out what was the underlying reason. It's usually not because the parent's using. Sometimes it's because they don't have the bus fare to get there, no one to give it to them, or things like that, or they're dirty, they have no clothes, and they stink, and they can't just go, and it's raining, So just to really find out, and how I've learned what parents receive better from caseworkers is, oh my gosh, I see you missed that hearing. What's going on? What can I do to help you? And then parents keep doing stuff. What I heard, learned that helps is that, you know what? I see you missing a lot of stuff. Man, my hands are getting tired. I can't ever bring your, I want to get your kid home, but I can't bring him home if we miss these things. What can we do to help you miss these things? To make these things and so you can get your kid back. Instead of saying, you missed that, or you're doing this wrong, flip it around in a positive, keeping the parent, keep their worth and their behavior separate. And then if they're messing up, throwing that carrot, hey, I really want your kid home. Remind parents. Sometimes we get so, and then we forget that you want my kid home, too. So just reminding that parent, and then when you have things that you can't do, and the parent's mad, the caseworker, social worker, social worker. The best way not to make a parent mad at you is to blame it on policy. You say, I would love to give you 3 more visits, but unfortunately, I have a supervisor and a policy that prevents me. But then also tell them what steps they got to take to get that. I hate one question a parent asks, when can my kid go home? I don't know. You know, kind of, right? Every social worker knows kind of. When you say, from my experience, your parent could please blah, 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 then we can talk about reunification. Don't just say, I don't know, and just leave me with that, because that means never.
Right. One thing I would say is, I just had it. One thing I would say is that sit down and talk with the parent and ask them about their kids. Before you talk about services and evaluations and all this other stuff, say, hi, Ms. Mays. I'm your social worker, and I'm here to help you. I'm here to help you try to safely reunify with your children. Tell me about your kids, right? And get them thinking about why they're even going to be talking to you, right? Instead of, list of services. I've seen so many times, and that was helpful for me when I met with the guardian ad litem. First thing she said, she didn't ask about my anything except for, tell me about your son, right? And I know in father's engagement, that's how I start off every group, is with a dad moment, right? Tell me something that makes you happy about being a dad, whether it's about a visit, you're not getting visits, we'll talk about that. But if you're not getting visits, tell me about a memory, right? Something that makes that, like, when you think about it, you're like, man, I'm so glad to be a dad, right? And having that connection, that mental connection with why am I here, right? Why? For my kids. I love my kids.
And to continue having feedback on what it takes for the next step. Keep giving a parent feedback and saying, hey, you're doing well, you might want to tighten it up here, or hey, a couple more, let's go, you know, if you continue this for 3 more months, let's look at it. You can't tell them what time, but that's huge. Because I don't know about any human being, because not knowing when, where, and what day
no you're coming sight. Home
is just
with horrible. No end in sight, I'm just going to do this forever.
Right, and so really a lot of language around timelines is important. Mm-hmm. You can say, I can't say exact date, but from my experience, let's go 3 months of this, let me get some people, you know, if you're doing well, we'll move to this part of the process. So give me
right.
Paint me a picture.
Right,
the
next steps. Right, the next
and
steps.
And then next steps in my hand while I leave your office.
If a parent comes in and says, I'm tired of this supervised visitation, they got social worker, how awkward is it? This person's over here taking all these notes, I'm trying to interact with my kid, right? I remember for me in visitation, my son, he's just a boy. He's a full boy through and through. Right, can't keep pants, can't keep shoes, they're all trash within a month, right? But football player, loves sports, loves to wrestle, right? First visit in the office, he comes running over, jumps on me, hanging off my neck, trying to get me to wrestle, and I'm like, hey, bud, we're not doing that. Right, we you see the social worker there? The supervisor behind the mirror? We ain't doing that. What's wrong with you? Come on. And he looked at me like, what is wrong with you? What is wrong with you? Throw me up in the air. Spin me around. You know what I mean? Swing me by my leg like this. You know what I mean? And letting my social worker said, parent like I'm not here so that I can help you, right? Don't change how you're doing. I have to put on my parent of the year jacket. You know what I mean? I won't be super dad today. I don't know how, but you know, my dad wasn't super dad. Yeah. His dad wasn't super dad. I ain't even met grandpa. You know what I mean? But it's like I don't have that example either, right, in my life, but now all of a sudden I got to be super dad.
That's a huge issue you brought up about visits, because one of the leading barriers to cases not moving forward is you'll hear about what you didn't do quite well or bad weeks, months later, and never get any coaching around it. Just bad visit report. And then you see it at the court hearing. So now you thought it was a great visit. This is how I was parented. We must be doing great, right? And you hear something 6 weeks later. It doesn't give parents time to mitigate any of the issues that are being brought up because they don't find out about them to court. There's a big giant pile, and now I'm mad at you because you could have told me that, and plus I don't see it like that. Crazy person. So
then right, why didn't you tell me that?
It sets a parent back.
You're just going to let me keep.
Or they won't believe it because it wasn't introduced in a way that a parent would receive it. If you put a whole bunch of crap on me at a court hearing, all of it's false. I don't care if it's 5 of it's true. It's a whole
right, everything's wrong. She's lying.
Step away from me.
Right.
So I want to make sure that you all have time to run through. I know you had some slides that you wanted to get through about the program.
Yes.
But maybe we can end by you telling us a little bit about, almost like the reverse, sort of talking about what you're doing and how the story ended and your family. And
I'll go first. Yours is longer than mine. So today I'm a contracted social service worker with the State Office of Public Defense. I carry a caseload. I get assigned those cases by an attorney. We have a great program out in Washington State called the Parents Representation Program, not confused with Parents for Parents. And I get assigned a caseload and I work with parents. I carry typically about 30 cases. I'm also the overseer. I facilitate a group and I've helped train another dad to start another group in King County. I oversee the father's engagement work in King County. Sit on committees, Fatherhood Coalition, and different state committees as far as fatherhood engagement and different things like that. I'm also a member of the Children's, Youth, and Family Services Advisory Committee with the Assistant Secretary of Children's Administration and other different stakeholders, the CFWS Program Manager and the CPS Program Manager. And it's an advisory committee. It's also one of our state's 3 CRPs, Citizen Review Panel, which is part of the 4E waiver requirement. I am a proud dad of my son, and then I was married, so now I'm also the proud dad of six other children. And so her and I together, we have seven children, lovely children. In our home, we have, they range from 16 down to 9 and a half. And then I have we have our little grandbaby that's in our house as well with mom. And so it's a full household and it's busy and I love it most of the time. What I can tell you is that each of my children are uniquely themselves. My biological son, who's 9 and a half, he'll be 10 in March. He loves football, anything sports. His stepbrother is the polar opposite. He likes fashion, and he likes dancing, and yoga, and art, and music. His sister is kind of mixed between both. She likes sports, and she likes the cheerleading and the dance and all that other stuff. My stepson taught himself how to play the guitar. You know, plays three different guitars, bass, acoustic, and electric guitar. Great artist. My 20-year-old is a tattoo artist. She's interning with one of the, he's world famous tattoo artists in Seattle. 17-year-old, she's recently moved out. 16-year-old, she's doing great. She was on the high school varsity football team until she decided that she didn't want to be known as that girl that plays football. She's like, I have an identity. My name is Haley. I'm like, well, but honey, you're a varsity football player. What are you doing?
Can you share a little bit about the 17-year-old, how you navigated that? Do you feel comfortable?
So my 17-year-old, she's, you know, we've gone through a lot in the last 4 years. We've gone through a lot with her. At rescue petition, I don't know if that's available out here, but we have that. We tried that. We tried treatment. She's been committed to a couple of mental health wards. Our house is a recovery house. We do not use. We have a zero tolerance policy. And she, you know, we understood, we're not ignorant either. We know, understand that our kids are going to experiment. It doesn't matter what our example is, right? And she just made choices, you know what I mean? And, you know, it came to a point where we said, you know, you're 17 and a half and you want to just, this is your third inpatient. Me being who I am, I have a lot of connections in the service industry. She had relapsed again. I was able to get her drug and alcohol assessment and a bed date within a couple of days. And she said, you know what, I mean, I understand. She said, I don't want to go today. Tuesday works out better for me. And we just said, you know what, that's your choice, you know. I hope you're safe, but we have four other very impressionable children, and we can't just continue thinking of just you. We love you, we want you to be safe, but you know, we have these other children that we have to think about. So, it's.
So I forgot the question. What was it again?
What you doing now?
I
don't know why I'm talking about that.
So, what I'm doing now is a lot of stuff. So, right now, I sit on about way too many committees, local, state, and national, work groups, task force, so I'm really busy in...
10.
Huh?
10.
10?
10 committees.
I'm really, really busy in helping, what I believe is not only helping the parents, but also helping the system, so I really, I'm a big proponent, and so is Washington State now. Every single table that embodies decisions that are about child welfare constituents has a youth and a parent on it. So we helped change, I was one of the ones that helped change that in Washington, so that's a given. So I sit on a lot of tables. I am currently a Washington State Office of Public Defense social worker, working, same as him, working with caseloads. I get assigned specialty cases. I'm a forensic social worker and expert consultant. I've been pulled on to cases that are going really bad, and they'll pick up I come in, I either help the attorney do some stuff differently, or I help the department do some stuff differently, bring in experts that I feel are going to help turn the case around for the parent, you know. So I get a lot of those side jobs. And I'm the one who created a model, with my parent ally, assistant, my great ex-boss. The model that got passed in the law by Governor Inslee last year is my baby. They hired me in 2009, and by a year, within 6 months, the same county, another court wanted me to start another one there, so I was in grad school doing all that, and managed to get two programs up and running, and changed it so much to where it was promising practice like 2 years or 3 years ago. I've been here 3 years, but anyway, 2.5 years into it, we became promising practice, and then the Governor Inslee passed into law last year. First, Administrative Office of Courts made it the statewide model, and we trained 10 counties to implement it in their county. Then, when the funding kept being precarious, we just went to the state legislature, and it went through unanimously. One House, the Senate, it was unanimous, and the House is only 3 no's. So, I mentor about 10 people who are in prison right now, moms and dads. I go into the prisons and speak. I'm everywhere. And then somehow, people from other counties and states find my number. I don't know how, but I'm on the phone all day and helping people navigate family law. I know a lot of stuff. And I don't know how I get this. I have to get my phone number. So, Judge so-and-so, who? Or, I don't know. So, someone are finding me.
I have to get my number. Kimberly Mays gave it to me.
Oh, I know. Oh, can I share something about Jason, though? He is a father engagement guru. We call him the man maker. Because men come to the system, they don't know how to. A lot of men wasn't raised by dads, blah, blah, blah. But I've seen him some of his best clients are African-American male straight from prison.
Jason, what we do now, man?
But what's so beautiful about Jason, I don't know what he does. That's why I keep giving your number. I'm so sorry. Is that a man will have all these issues, and all of a sudden the first thing that got me was the first year you took that position, all the dads beat the moms out. Yeah. Beat the moms, and they were, most of the dads end up being sole custody, making a parent family the mom, which is a twist. Mm-hmm. And so he had just 2 dads came out of prison, straight out of prison 4 months, right? They were 4 months out. Was it 4 months out or just out? No, just out. Within 4 months, both of those dads had the boys home. But they were at term. Was one at term?
One was
at term, one wasn't. And so whatever he did, went to the attorney and said, hey, you thought about this? And Terry said, no, I haven't. So he gave him an idea. He's really helpful. We're really helpful in helping the system, either state attorneys or social workers, with concepts that people don't even think about. So he was able to not only get those dads, get the babies home, but then he went on Facebook and filled their whole house up. Furniture, clothes, everything. So he's amazing.
Let's open it up just for a couple of questions, and you'll have a chance to ask questions.
Can I say one more thing? I'm sorry. That resume, curriculum vitae, as you see, is a standard of parent allies in our system. Most parent allies, because what I did was I made a program into a workforce development program, so I would mentor parents on the floor, hire the criminal prop, sit them on all the committees I was on, right? And then help them all go to college. And then sit with Jason, he's just really on his own about college. And so he's just ridiculously brilliant. He's teaching me now. But anyway,
it's the generative capacity.
Yeah. So generative capacity meaning that as we work with parents and get them in college and get them working, and then they go to other jobs. Now we have our first CPS social worker now in MSW who has a criminal history and multiple cases, and she's going to be our first CPS worker in Washington State. And we're literally working. And one girl, Elisa, who's come with us, she's over the policy and the innovations for parent strategies, and legislators meet with her. She's high up meeting with legislators to draft policies that impact families. And so Washington State has found it proven not only to generate their own, reinvest in parents, formally involved, and then start, now the agencies that serve our families are hiring them. So we have supervisors of the mental health agencies who are parent allies. So we just infiltrated our, not only our child welfare system, but also the systems that impact our families, because what better way, this is how I help agencies start hiring our families. What better way than have a constituent's brain right in your house,
right,
doing a bachelor's degree, master's degree, doing your job, but now when you have any kind of policy decisions, the brain's already in the room, and that helps reduce unintended consequences and making policy decisions that are not relevant to the population.
Yeah. So let's put it up to any questions that people have right now, and then we have a PowerPoint that they prepared about the sort of the program. Anything, any questions about it?
Do you think a parent ally is better than an NA sponsor?
They're two different things. A parent ally is someone that has been through the system, successfully navigated the system, and got their child returned to them. I guess I could be counted as both now, because I'm an NA and I do NI sponsor guys. But had no one that I was talking to at the time, except for the one person that I met, had been through the system. So none of my support groups, so they didn't understand what I was going through. Half of my support group, when I talked about when they presented me with the housing opportunity, half of my support group said, take the housing. The other half said, you know, just wait it out. You already got a house. Why waste a resource? Right? And so it was split. But I mean, I guess it could be one and the same person. Yeah.
But for NA is for drug and alcohol. Everybody, so parent ally is specifically tailored to families who are navigating the system. And there's nobody who can bring that whole concrete piece, but a person, you know, anybody who's been through something can bring more than anybody else. So I would say that having parent allies in this field of all echelons, so I start strategically hiring not only ethnicities, different color, skin color, to represent the families in our system. I start hiring strategically for parents with the issues that brought their kids to care. So we have some mental health, substance abuse, domestic violence, inappropriate discipline, things like that. So I would strategically hire Spanish speaking, bilingual, you know, so I was able to really get it home to the work.
Joe, you had your hand up.
Yeah, I think she partially answered my question. It was about the pairing of the parent partner. Do you try to match them as closely as possible by the barriers that the parent is facing based on, or?
Sometimes if it comes out, but basically the thing we have all in common is I've been through it, I understand, so there's no judgment, and I can hand walk you to the through this process and help you not reinvent the wheel to get to your kid. No one needs to reinvent the wheel here. You can just guide you through, coach you through. Lady in front first.
Hi, I really appreciated your presentation, and I don't want to start crying, but I wondered, you repeatedly said that you didn't want to be where you were, but you had no support. Mm-hmm. And I want to imagine a society formed of all of us where the support is there for you before you get there, before you get into the system. What are you thinking we could do in that place?
Well, someone to help a person navigate their problems. Which our systems are, the funding has been cut in all the systems that used to keep people out of our system. So it's really a hard question to answer. Without the right, so if someone has substance abuse, they need substance abuse treatment. If they can't get in a reasonable time, they can very well get exasperated itself and get to a point where they're going to come in before they can get in treatment. They have mental health issues. Someone needs to help them navigate that, because a lot of people aren't taught. Most of all, I've learned, even though I was raised upper class, spoiled, rotten brat, you know, had a lot of money, my special issues was just different. And I got really bad just being a bad kid versus coming from, but I've met a lot of people in my drug use with no real family, dad, mom, uncles, and all that kind of support. So if you don't have none of that in your life and you want to get mental health services, I don't know who would be assigned to do that. Or if you need whatever. So a lot of people need assistance in getting this, finding what services out there, just don't even have the hope to even look for it. And some people need to be hand-walked for 2 months. Some parents, I'll hand-walk them, but there's one mom, I'm still hand-walking them. But
She went from termination to getting her extended visits, and so I'm still hand walking her. Her issues were significant. And some parents, you might help for five days, one day, 5 minutes, 20 minutes, 80 minutes, it just depends. But just having human beings who are willing to, they don't know, to invest in that family parent to say, what do you need? Who knows? Every family needs something different. But there's needs human beings to help them navigate that and to give them hope that I'm going to be with you until you can walk on your own.
Yeah, I was just working with the dad, and he's at termination. Homeless in a tent. He actually set his tent up across the street from the visitation center so that he could...
Be on time?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Needing sleep. And I met with the dad, and I was talking with him, and I was talking with him about his phone, and he said, well, I just need to get a new one. And I said, well, how do we get you a new phone? And he said, I just need $6.
Wow. Mm.
And so I took him down to the store and got him that phone for $6. He said that was the turnaround piece, that someone showed up at my appointment. He didn't know I was going to be there. I showed up at his appointment, bought him a $6 phone, and now he's in treatment. He's got an appointment for housing afterwards. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's just that little piece of like, oh, wow, someone cares for you.
I'm glad you
to ask me.
And I'm glad you get some phones. That's another thing. You need to find a funding piece. Because me and him buy our clients' phones. If a client has a phone, that's what I'm doing. And Metro PC, you know, $30 a month, da-da-da. So I go get them a phone, and I let them know, I will pay this $30 a month until you can, right? But if you don't engage in your services, you just fall off the map, that's a phone. I'm not paying crap. So I have, like, four people I'm paying now. But eventually, so that one phone revolutionized their life. I give unlimited data, $35 a month, $35, whatever. And that's what we do a lot. That's the first thing I do, make sure they have a phone. And then I put them in my car, first visit, and I take them all their appointments. I figure out what they need, mental health services, and we're going to hit all those places. I make it time it where we're going to hit all those appointments. So now you're signed up. Take them to lunch, have that talk, and that's the foundation. But definitely need, but somebody needs to buy people. So those 2,150-minute cell phones, this is what happens. Murphy's Law says that every time you need that phone, that 250-minute phone, it's going to stop on you. The minute's going to go at the worst time. And then you can't call this and that because you need a minute for a case. So that's ugly. The government needs to give free unlimited. That data don't cost nobody nothing. That's free. Airwaves. So anyway, that's a piece that will significantly help the parents. If anybody want to start a little nonprofit to get parents those Metro PC phones, that would revolution. And then put a care stick there. Your condition of us paying $30 a month, you got to show documentation that you've done your crap, or, you know. So
services.
Then, services.
Yeah, I just wanted to say something about Jason's presentation. And particularly the last thing about the homeless man. You did a kindness to that man. And I think he then is able to say, you know, I really do love my child, which in some way is an exposure if you're in this conflict situation. Mm-hmm. You know, it would be easier for some guy to say, oh, let her have her, you know, stay and take care of her, you know. And I think getting to the emotional part of parenthood for a lot of dads is really difficult when they're in this situation.
You bring up a good point, because I see a lot of dads, especially from different cultures, mm-hmm. Penalizing their visitation notes. I was working with a few Hispanic fathers, and they were visiting with the mother, and they had a baby, and dad's not changing diapers. Dad's not feeding. Well, culturally, mom feeds the baby and changes the diapers. But he's being penalized in his visitation notes because he's not doing that. But his dad didn't do that. His grandpa didn't do that. His grandpa before that, we know, didn't do that. Right? And no one's talking to him and teaching him, right? And so it took me looking at that and saying, hey, every visit, change a diaper. Why? I'm not saying that the system should be like this. I'm just saying that it is like this, right? So we have to adapt ourselves. You're being penalized because you don't change a diaper, right? Just change a diaper. Demonstrate that, right? That's what... You know what I mean? And having that conversation, And through father's engagement, we talk about being a nurturing father. I learned through the system through trainings and different parenting classes that I've taken since my dependency was dismissed, about what it looks like to be a nurturing father, because I didn't have that, yeah. Right? And then being able to talk to dads about being a nurturing father and what that looks like, and be able to have that real conversation with them, because that's what they're being graded on, you know, best practices and all these different ideas, right? And these concepts that have never been introduced to, if I had to take a stab at it, 90% of the families that are in the system. Mm-hmm. They've never heard of what a nurturing father looked like. When I was younger, well, first my dad wasn't there for like, you know, ever. But then when I had a stepdad, it was like he didn't talk. And if dad loved you, that's because the fridge was full and the lights were on, right? And that was how dad expressed love. Dad got up and went to work every day. Dad was tired, dad got the big piece of chicken.
You know? Yeah. Can I share something too about the love piece? And I heard when you said something about when his act of kindness caused the dad to think about his child, how much he loved the child. What I learned was we can't do it for our kids. My other cases, I tried to do it for my kids. It won't stick. Mm-hmm. You help parents do it for themselves because they deserve it too, mm-hmm. Right? And if I do it for me, then my kids benefit. Then it's for my kids because I've done it for me and it's going to stick. So I want to change that perception. Do this for your kids. Until I love me, I'm going to love anybody else right. And that's until I love me right. Mm-hmm. And just want to remember that. And by showing that extra kindness and patience and love helps a person, especially parents in the system, who are, every parent in front of you, seriously, throughout almost, are battling with self-loathing. Mm-hmm. Not just guilt and remorse, self-loathing. What does one do when you self-loathe? You self-destruct. You sabotage every positive effort you have. So while we're pointing fingers and looking like, oh, she missed that. If we can reach that human being and let them know that your work is separate from your behavior. You have I'm a person worthy. You are a person worthy of dignity and respect. And you have the free will to choose your behavior, and you're responsible for the actions you choose. But to continue to make that parent feel this behavior is jacked up, gotta go. But you are so valuable and needed by your children, and I know they need you so bad, and you need you, and just really helping them see that I'm worth it, because a lot of them, it's generational. You know, and there's no one that told them they was worth a crap.
Right, mom said you ain't no milk to nothing, dad said you're
worthless. So until you feel worth the crap, like the gentleman did when he said, man, he took his time to take me to this place and get the thing, I must be worth a crap.
So we're trying to get together, the county court has got together a parent pro program. There's been a lot of discussion about how to structure the program, and from what I'm hearing from the two of you, you work in the public defender's office.
We used to be parent for parent. Now we're PRP.
You work out of the public defender lawyer office, right?
Right. We work with them.
And I think I think that's a missing piece in our county, because it's too tangential. You know, it's hard to. Well, by that I mean, you know, I got to grab this parent pro if I see him or I call him. It's one more thing I got to do,
yeah.
As opposed to somebody being on my team. I'm an attorney that does a fair amount of this work. So I like that idea.
You need both, though, ma'am. You got to have both. It's not enough. We can't have 30.
Even though I now carry a caseload of 30, and then I work with about 15 dads through father's engagement. There's parent programs in King County and in 10 counties in Washington. And when I'll have a parent that calls me and says, you know, what, someone on my caseload, and say, oh, I need, you know, so-and-so or whatever, right? And I'll say, you know what? There's this parent ally working at the courthouse. Go down there. It's on turnstile,
yeah.
2 or 3. Connect with this parent ally, and they will help you, yeah. Get connected with what you need, right? Because I mean, I have a giant, and that's a need where I can say, oh, I know my parent, I know the parent, my client that I'm working with, and I can say, boom,
plug it in. If I could reframe sort of Kim's question, it seems like nationally there's a different models about where
yes.
you house parent partners, with the attorney's office, with the court,
yes.
In Wayne County, where you'll be in December, it's with the Department
yeah.
of Human Services, the people who employ the parent
yeah.
partners. Give an opinion on what's the most effective way, and where you know
to start or
no? Where they should be housed?
All three.
Okay.
Do you have a tight system? I can't even imagine how tight. Right now we have two, but once we used to have the one with the one only one lone CPS. But we used to have one in the office in Vancouver. But if you can have in the department one or two to help mitigate that, what we do, what our main role is to
angry parents
to reduce
the
anger and the block and the rejection of this process, and to help parents embrace this process as an answer to prayer. It's not going to be fun and pretty, but it's going to help if you embrace it, and we help them buy into the idea of whatever you were saying. So you say, mommy's a ba-da-da-da. And mom's like, I'm not, no way. And then we'll go 5 minutes. Okay, I can do that. It's great. So I'm doing this stuff. So
no,
we're
I
buying.
Understand the program.
Yeah. Okay. So
I'm just saying that, well, I think one of the, there have been a lot of discussions of which I've not been a part of, but I think it was interesting to hear that you were embedded. Part of what you do is that you're embedded in a law office.
Yes, it's very
and
good.
I think that's an important component. And I do like the concept that you just saying about being embedded in the agency. Because I
court.
Think the agencies can be a barrier
yes.
to all those dynamics you discussed earlier.
I just want to add that we're so grateful that Jason and Kim are staying tonight. They're not leaving. Their flight is for tomorrow. So after lunch, the stakeholders or you know some of us will be meeting with them to talk just about the nuts and bolts.
Yeah.
So Kim's question is really important to us. We have to give it a home. It has to be funded. You know all those kinds of things. So that's we're going to be, you know, taking everything we can get out of them to learn from them, so that we can put it on the table and figure out what is the best configuration for this community. But I absolutely hear what Kim is saying, and it's something that we really, really have to discuss and figure out. So the good part of that is that we have, you know, the diversity of stakeholders. DHHS is at the table. Parent attorneys are at the table. Some from the public defender's office. Prosecutor's office is at the table, so we have some key folks who are hopefully will think it through and land somewhere so that we can really get it rooted.
I would love to converse with a few of them just with some quick tips on how inexpensively some of these ideas can
yeah,
be implemented.
So that's what I want to hear, and I'll be here for the conversation.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to transition into the PowerPoint. One thing I forgot to do was pass out the handout sheet, sign-in sheet. Just sign in your name and email address.